5 and 21. Copy.
Standing at the precipice of the next century and looking back, the world is a strikingly smaller place. The last 100 years have brought people around the globe closer through a host of remarkable inventions, ranging from the telegraph to the communications satellite.
Hello, Your Royal Highness, sir.
And congratulations for this beautiful procedure.
Be pleased and proud to have a representative from your country.
Yet communication can take many forms. It can be as subtle as the smile of a child or the gesture of an athlete. Sport itself is a form of communication, a form which brings people of diverse cultures, political systems, and values into a single arena for a single purpose. One worldwide sport, above all others, requires as well as promotes communication on multiple levels, the sport of volleyball.
Communication is what volleyball is all about. Nothing can be done in volleyball without communicating each other.
You always have to know who is going to make the next play and anticipate what the opponent's going to do and try to be prepared for that, and that demands communication.
やっぱり競った場面になるとどうしても自分の中に閉じこもってしまうっていうようなところがありますよね。だからそういう時っていうのはやっぱりお互いアイコンタクトを取るなりっていうか、ただ本当に触ってあげるというかタッチしてあげるっていうか、そういうスキンシップじゃないですけど、そういうのも大事だし、まあどれだけっていうことですよね、聞いたのは。
In a scant 100 years, volleyball has come to enjoy the position of the world's most widely played sport next to soccer.Hundreds of millions of people participate in the game today, while 210 member nations comprise the International Volleyball Federation, the largest sports federation in the world. It's been called the sport of the 90s, non-contact. Played on almost equal levels by both men and women, volleyball displays power, grace, and sex appeal. A game enjoyed both indoors and in the open air. A sport played by some of the world's top athletes,or just for fun by people of all ages. Volleyball has traveled the same path as the century's history and events. It is indeed poised for great things during the next 100 years. Yet how humble were its beginnings a century ago. During the second half of the 19th century, young men flocked to the growing industrial cities of America. In 1851, the Young Men's Christian Association, the YMCA, was formed to provide Christian fellowship and to promote a healthy lifestyle. Sports came to be employed as a major vehicle to keep young men entertained and sheltered from the temptations of the street.Gymnasiums sprung up all over America, and the YMCA created its first school in Springfield, Massachusetts in 1885 to train physical directors to carry out its national program of physical and moral education. New sports such as basketball were invented there, and YMCA membership grew to include men of all ages. But basketball was found to be too strenuous for middle-aged businessmen.So a young physical director at nearby Holyoke YMCA, William Morgan, began experimenting with a new, more genteel game. In 1895, he created a new sport, volleyball. The sport of volleyball 100 years ago would hardly be recognizable today. Initially called Mintonette, the first 10 rules were vague and given to widely different interpretations. Any number of players could be on the court, patting the bladder of a basketball back and forth across a tennis net of varying height. The game languished in America, but slowly evolved with standardized rules and new playing techniques. By 1916, the YMCA hierarchy saw volleyball as a non-competitive recreational activity.
To create a game in which thousands of men, boys, and girls all over the world would indulge with real enjoyment
became the stated mission of volleyball's early fathers. This goal was realized during the early part of the century when YMCA missionaries exported the ideals of Christianity and wholesome sports around the world. Volleyball became a great communicator of YMCA ideals. Volleyball began its long trek in 1900 when it was introduced to Canada, to Cuba in 1906, to Peru in 1911, Brazil in 1915, and Mexico in 1917. In 1905, volleyball headed east. That year, the sport was introduced to China. 3 years later, in 1908, volleyball came to Japan. In 1910, American YMCA ambassadors carried the sport to India and the Philippines. The game in the Far East soon came to take on a different look. 16 players on a side in time diminished to 12, then 9. With three lines of three players, the game became highly specialized. Team strategies of offense and defense evolved, but it was in the Philippines where the game took its first great hold. By 1914, more than 5,000 courts were found in public schools, playgrounds, and private clubs. In the Philippines, modern rules also evolved. After one team set the ball back and forth between themselves 52 times before hitting it over the net, the local rules committee demanded the first three-hit rule, which soon became universal. And here as well, a modern version of a spike was unleashed, the Filipino bomb. Even while other types of bombs began to fall in Europe. When the United States entered the conflict, volleyball, which had served as an ambassador of international peace, now became linked with war. General John Blackjack Pershing, commander of the arriving American Expeditionary Forces, ordered that his troops be provided with exercise during times of inactivity. The YMCA International Physical Directors were enlisted to oversee this fitness program. In 1919, 16,000 volleyballs were transported to the European front, where 1.5 million men played the game during lulls in the fighting. After the war, the Yanks returned home, and they left behind a legacy for Europeans. Volleyball was introduced to Great Britain in 1914 and France in 1917. By the end of the decade, the game had spread to Yugoslavia, Czechoslovakia, Poland, and the Soviet Union. In the United States, the end of the war signaled a period of increased prosperity and leisure. New inventions like the radio and the mass-produced automobile forever changed the landscape of America. The jazz age had begun, and volleyball was just another diversion. While the game remained a diversion in the YMCAs of America, volleyball flourished as a competitive athletic sport in most other parts of the world. International competitions were initiated. In 1921, Japan sent its first team abroad to compete in the 5th Far East Championship in Shanghai. In Latin America, the sport saw the men's international competition in 1929 at the Central American and Caribbean Games in Havana. Volleyball was added to the program of the 1932 Games in San Salvador, including teams from Mexico, Cuba, and El Salvador, while in South America, Peru was beginning to build its outstanding volleyball tradition. On the beaches of California, a new version of the game was about to emerge. In the 1930s, movies captured the imagination of the world. Communication between nations and diverse cultures became personal and humanized like never before. Hollywood was the entertainment capital of the planet. Perched above a Southern California paradise, movie stars would descend to frolic on the beautiful beaches of Santa Monica. And, as in most things, Southern California would devise its own brand of volleyball. Paul Johnson, the man credited with playing the first beach doubles game, still strolls at the site of the game's invention.
I played the first beach doubles at Santa Monica Athletic Club in 1930. We played there for a few years, and we moved up to the swimming club, which is right next door. We decided no spiking and no blocking. And pretty soon they got mad at me because they thought I spiked when I didn't. I thought I didn't. They thought I did. So everything goes. Go ahead and spike if you want to.
Always a place to experiment, the clubs of Santa Monica soon saw women joining men on the sand. And a new version of the game, mixed volleyball, developed. Volleyball was one of the early sports to bridge the sexes.
And I came up on the beach, and these men and women, some women, playing volleyball. They had set up the net, and so I asked if I could get in on the game, and they said, sure.
We used to play and play, and pretty soon you'd run out of gas, you'd jump in the ocean, cool off, and then lay in the sun.
I swam a lot, but this was a sport that you did falls and you kept yourself in shape, and so that was primarily my thought of playing the game.
By 1940, the best indoor American players were playing in the YMCAs at night and on the beach during the day. Yet almost overnight, the beaches of California were deserted when in 1941, the United States plunged into a war which had already entangled most of the world for 2 years. Places of leisure everywhere were transformed into battlegrounds. As in the First World War, the portability of balls and nets kept American GIs playing volleyball during lulls in the combat. From the ashes of history's most devastating war, new hope rose for world peace, including international exchange and the growth of sports. Like the United Nations, volleyball would soon serve to bring many nations together. In 1947, 14 countries assembled in Paris to form the International Volleyball Federation, the FIVB. Paul Lebeau, a Frenchman, was elected the first FIVB president. Volleyball competition, under the leadership of the new FIVB, soon spread across national boundaries. In 1948, the first European championships were held in Rome. And in 1949, Prague hosted the first world championships for men. With 10 countries competing, the Soviets edged Czechoslovakia for the gold medal. Unknown to the world beyond the Iron Curtain, the Soviets had popularized volleyball in the 1930s, and developed the first of a long line of stars, Anatoly Chinilin.
В нашей стране было много популярных волейболистов, которых знала страна, знали наши люди. До войны это были очень популярные волейболисты: Чинилин, Щагин. После военное время Савин.
In Prague, the Soviets displayed their style of awesome power and discipline, while the defense of the great Kaxel Paulus demonstrated the emerging Czech trademark of superior floor play. The serve was still taken overhand, but new playing innovations were also revealed in Prague. Penetration of the setter from the back row and the three-hitter attack were first performed in an international competition. In 1951, the FIVB adopted the important rule of allowing the hands to pass over the net during the block and spike. Soon after the war's end, optimism for a new cooperation among nations darkened with the dropping of the Iron Curtain. East was set against West under the threat of nuclear war. The struggle took many forms, including competition in the technological, economic, cultural, and sports arenas.
Я думаю, что система
развитие спорта в Советском Союзе было одна из самых передовых в мире. В целом социалистическая система предполагала, и не только предполагала, но и делала все для того, чтобы государство занималось развитием спорта.
The Soviet system of full-time training, subsidization of athletes, and extensive competition propelled their teams into dramatic superiority in many sports. Communist bloc countries soon dominated international volleyball competition. Volleyball was now a voice to communicate political ideals. In 1952, 8 teams competed in Moscow at the first men's and women's world championships. The Soviet women emerged victorious in that event, followed by Poland, then Czechoslovakia. The Soviet men, known as the Gold Six, captured their second world championship. It was already clear. The communist bloc countries had assumed leadership of the sport for both women and men. Still, the sport was developing elsewhere in the world. In 1955, the first Asian volleyball championships were held in Tokyo. That same year, the second Pan American Games were held in Mexico City.
I attended the Pan American Games in Mexico City. I saw for the first time thousands of people queuing to enter a volleyball match. And I saw the gates of this small stadium crowded. And nobody could enter, nobody could access. At the end, 5,000 people were packing a 3,000 stadium only to watch the final of the Pan American Games. At the end, I found myself hanging from the roof to watch the United States playing against Mexico. I was convinced, like many other fans, that volleyball is a major sport, the sport for spectators, the sport of the future.
The World Championships came to the West in 1956, when both men's and women's competitions were held in Paris. For most Western teams, it was the first chance to experience the advanced play and power of the communist countries. In a dramatic Cold War showdown between the two superpowers, the Soviet men played the American team. It was a humbling experience for the United States.
World Volleyball Championship at the Palace of Sports in Paris. And here you see an all-California squad in white uniforms playing a representative of Russia. Seldom seen beyond school days, volleyball is an exciting sport and highly demanding in teamwork and physical condition. Volleyball is like most net sports, but utilizing a ball about the size of a basketball and where the hand has to be as quick as the eye. The Russians are most expert at the sport, and let's hope that in the future the only volleys between the USA and the USSR will be with a volleyball. That would be a welcome net
game. For the Americans, one of the few bright spots of the tournament was the selection of number 2, Gene Selznick, for the all-world team. A master of detente, Selznick took knowledge from the Soviets and gave back his unique brand of goodwill.
Playing against the Russians was a different experience. The Russians never talk on the court. You know, their game is we're out here to play and there's no conversation. And we try to talk to them over the net and they just look right through you, you know. And we made friends with the Russians later on. I was trying to teach the Russians and the Czechs how to blow bubble gum. They all stand around me and I'm just screwing around, you know. And they'd come out, you know, and then I'd pop it, you know, and they thought it was the greatest thing going.
But on the court, the greatest things going were the Czech men and the Soviet women.
Monsieur Libeau, président de la Fédération Française et de la Fédération Internationale de Volleyball, remet le trophée des champions au capitaine tchèque Vali. À son tour, Chudina, capitaine de l'équipe féminine de l'URSS, reçoit la récompense attribuée à l'équipe championne.
A challenge to Soviet domination would soon surface in the Far East. In 1957, volleyball was legitimized as a world-class sport when the International Olympic Committee voted to include it in the 1964 Olympics in Tokyo. the world came to Tokyo in 1964 and discovered a new spectator sport. Japanese fans had already embraced volleyball, particularly their fabulous Japanese women's national team. In 1960, at the World Championships in Rio de Janeiro, the Japanese women came breathtakingly close to taking the gold medal from the Soviets. Their hard-driving coach, Hirofumi Daimatsu, began to devise new techniques to defeat the bigger and stronger Soviet women. He concentrated on flawless passing and aggressive backcourt defense. His relentless, almost inhuman training sessions shocked the sports world.
体育館の床の上ですから、しかもこの大きな人たちが転がるって言ったって、ドッテッと倒れるみたい。痛くて痛くて、そんなことはできないんです。で、転がるだけじゃダメなんです。じゃあ床にボールを置いて、置いてあるボールを上げるのと同時に転がるって言われたらもうそれできないんですね。転がることはできるんだけど、ボールを上げながら転がるってできなくて、一回上げてから、あっっていう感じで、またそれができない。
Daimatsu promised his women that if they could endure the training, they would win the Olympic gold.
For the first time in Olympic history, volleyball is listed as an official event here in the Tokyo Games. Finals in the women's event between the USSR and Japan. Japan won the first set 15-11 and the second set 15-8. Teams are now battling in the third of a possible five-set match to determine who gets a gold medal and who a silver. Japanese girls have developed a new defense method to overcome the handicap of their small stature. The player throws herself into a roll, she hits the ball, and still lands on her feet. Miyamoto of Japan, a southpaw young left-handed girl. There it is, good strong over the net, the far court. Russian side turn, and the whistle!
まあ、鬼の大松という意味ありまして、まあ、厳しいとか怖いとかいうあれはまあ一般的によく知られてるんですけれども、うん、ただ厳しくて怖い人にはやっぱりついていけないですね。私はもう最終的には大松監督という人間性、厳しさと優しさ、そして何よりも選手のためを思った練習であることを選手が理解納得できたからついていけたんだと思います。
Japan celebrated its new heroines and the Mama-san phenomenon blossomed. Millions of schoolgirls and housewives began playing volleyball. For the men in the first Olympics, the seemingly invincible Soviet machine continued to roll over all opponents and easily won the gold. Anatoly Chinilin and Vladimir Savin, the nation's volleyball legends, had passed the mantle to a new generation of Soviet athletes. Team captain Yuri Chesnikov soon emerged as the Soviet's new superstar. Soviet volleyball players achieved the stature of national heroes and became friends with celebrities such as cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin. When the Japanese women proved that Soviet domination could be broken, the same dream for the men was born. One top coach, Yasutaka Matsudaira, was sent to the Soviet Union to study coaching techniques.
私にとってやっぱ幸せだったことは、その時にソ連のサビンというバレーボール協会の会長なんですが、最も優秀なですね、アナトリー・エイヌ・ゴルンというね、監督ですね、まあ、その人はもう当時その引退してましたけれども、第一線を退いたばっかりの、もうほやほやのですね、第一線の監督さんだった人を、レニングラードの方なんですが、私の先生に3ヶ月間つけてくれたわけです。
Promoted to head coach of the men's team in 1965, Matsudaira embarked on his 8-year plan to win the Olympic gold. The 68 Olympics in Mexico City proved that it would take at least 8 years to upend Soviet domination. Led by the high-leaping Yuri Bugienkov, the Nureyev of volleyball, the Russian offense excelled. In the final match, Bugienkov and his comrades kept their Soviet superiority intact. For the women, past glory and a gold medal again returned to the Soviet Union.
Gana la Unión Soviética.
In the eighth and final year of his plan, Matsudaira was in full command of his vision. At the Munich Olympics in 1972, the incredible Japanese offense, built on precision and deception around the little general Katsutoshi Nakoda, had dismantled every opponent 3-0 until the semifinals. Then a stubborn Bulgarian team, behind the spectacular spiking of huge Dmitry Slotkinov, nearly destroyed the Japanese dream. Nakoda and his teammates rallied from behind to defeat the Bulgarians. The final match was far less exciting. Japan easily toppled the German Democratic Republic for the gold medal, 3-1. As Matsudaira promised, after 8 years of intense effort, his team would earn its Olympic gold. ...1974 marked the first international television coverage of a volleyball match as the World Championships held in Mexico were broadcast around the globe. The beginning of the decade also witnessed the existence of star players with few athletic prospects beyond a career with their national team. But by the middle of the decade, the situation was changing. In the Western European countries, particularly Italy, professional volleyball leagues began to emerge and many international stars migrated to new opportunities.
In 1974, after I'd been playing for the U.S. team, and quite honestly, we weren't making any money. We were training all the time, living out of our cars half the time. I had an opportunity to go to Italy to play in their first division. And it was really somewhat of a financial decision. They were paying good money at that time. And also, I realized how much fun it was to be recognized for what we'd done for many years. And I don't think many of us played to be recognized because we knew that wasn't going to happen in our country. But it certainly did happen in Italy.
1976 was an Olympic year, and despite the financial opportunities in the pro leagues, many athletes represented their home countries at the games in Montreal. Under coach Hubert Wagner and a phenomenal center blocker, Tomasz Wojtowicz, the Polish men captured the gold medal. By detonating balls from behind the 3-meter line, Wojtowicz unveiled a new strategy which would change the way the game would be played in the future. For the women in 1976, the ongoing Soviet-Japanese battle continued. This time, the Japanese exhibited one of the most convincing performances in the sport's history. Behind the brilliant setting of Noriko Matsuda, the Japanese women allowed an average of only 6 points per game to the world's best teams. Montreal also marked the emergence of a new world power. The spectacular jumping and cannon arms of the Cuban men and women mesmerized fans. The high-flying Mercedes Perez proved that women could jump as high as many men. She led the marvelous Cuban women to the World Championships in 1978, the first team in history to win a major championship from the American zones. Politics entered the Olympic arena in 1980 when U.S. President Jimmy Carter announced a boycott of the Moscow Olympics. For volleyball, it made little impact, as both men's and women's favorites, the Soviets, dominated the field. For the men, the Soviet dynasty reached historic heights. Some experts claim that between 1977 and 1983, the Soviet dynasty was the greatest of the sport's history. Under the brilliant coach Platonov, Vyacheslav Zaitsev delivered perfect sets to Alexander Zavin, establishing the most fearsome middle attack the world had ever seen. The powerful Zavin served as the pillar of the ferocious Soviet blocking, which mercilessly shut down opponent after opponent. In the 1982 World Championships in Argentina, this team did not lose a single game. As the Soviet Empire began to weaken, its indomitable hold on international volleyball relaxed as well. In the land where the sport was born, America, a new power was emerging. The USA women began their ascent in the late 1970s, while for the American men, a group of incredibly talented athletes came out of college at the beginning of the 1980s. Powers, Dvorak, Buck, Timmons, and the greatest player of the decade, Karch Kirai, joined the team in 1981.
The U.S. was the dominant team in the 80s because we have a permanent training center based in San Diego, and we got to train together year-round. By playing together year-round for 3, 4, sometimes 5, and 6 years in a row, we established the best teamwork. So we had the best teamwork. We also had some of the best athletes who were playing volleyball anywhere in the world. And we had the best coaching with coaches like Doug Beal and Marv Dunphy.
With the promise of the Los Angeles Olympics, coach Doug Beal refined this raw talent into a finely tuned machine. They caught the imagination not only of the nation, but the world when they took the gold, even though the powerful Soviets and Cubans stayed home in their own boycott.
Gold medal match was just one of those close to perfect matches, I think, that the players play and the coaches coach and everybody kind of comes together and everything goes right and everything goes the way you diagrammed it and all the players play at their maximum ability and nobody makes any unforced mistakes. And it just was one of those great situations.
The silver medalist, Brazil, provided the only scare for the hometown fans. With their fiery jump serves, the South Americans knocked off the Americans in pool play. The jump serve was added to the arsenal of offensive weapons. Another new power emerged in LA, the Chinese women. Employing a new technique to confuse the block, the one-foot takeoff, their remarkable spiker, Long Ping, and setter, Yong Silan, disappointed the American public, and they easily defeated the USA women for the gold medal.
Je me suis demandé toujours, est-ce que c'est vraiment si loin que je joue? Est-ce que c'est vraiment golden? Ça c'est après le match, tout de suite, je me suis dit, qu'est-ce qu'il y a? Est-ce que c'est moi qui suis championnat? Je n'y crois pas. Et enfin, jusqu'à maintenant, on est, moi aussi, je suis comme toute l'équipe de chinoise, on est très très connus en Chine. Et j'ai reçu aussi plusieurs médailles.
Los Angeles 84 was the turning point for volleyball. With the retirement of Paul Lebeau after 37 years as FIVB president, Dr. Ruben Acosta, an international lawyer from Mexico, assumed the sport's highest position. Dr. Acosta brought a new vision to the sport.
I had in mind to make volleyball a top sport, a professional sport. I knew we could have thousands of spectators attending volleyball matches. I found that our sport was a hidden gold mine, waiting for somebody to discover it. Because so many thrilling moments during volleyball matches could not happen without thousands of people attending the different events. I was sure that with a little better organization and a more professional approach, we were able to build up a very spectacular sport event.
Upon taking office, Dr. Acosta moved the FIVB offices to Lausanne, Switzerland, the city where the International Olympic Committee is also based. Within 4 years, in 1988, the FIVB moved into a beautiful villa restored and furnished by architect Renato Morandi.
Thank you.
Federation was just starting at that moment to change from a very conservative, traditional approach to kind of competing in the international sports arena to a much more aggressive, modern marketing approach.
We had to change the concept from amateur sport to professional sport, from a volunteer's approach to a professional approach of people who care.
The sport could be cool and hip and employed as a marketing tool for multinational corporations, something volleyball had never exploited. A new dimension and increased spectator interest could be brought to the game by thoughtfully organizing beach doubles volleyball.
From the very moment I was elected president, we decided that we should organize beach volleyball world championships and that we will have professional beach volleyball events worldwide.
Dr. Acosta soon organized the first FIVB World Beach Volleyball Championships in 1987. Contested on the beaches of Ipanema, the championships were a tremendous success. The American team of St. John Smith and Randy Stoklas prevailed in a closely contested match with countrymen Karch Kirai and Pat Powers. Smith, who was instrumental in organizing professional beach volleyball in the United States, and his partner Stoklas would continue to be a dominating force in beach volleyball for the next 5 years. Americans also continued to dominate indoor volleyball when the Olympics went to Seoul, Korea in 1988. The golden era of American volleyball continued as the Yanks won a consecutive gold medal, answering any questions of their premier ranking. For unlike 1984, the Soviets were in attendance. A silver medal for the Peruvian women signaled the culmination of a long-standing volleyball tradition in this South American country. Their valiant effort came just short of upsetting the Soviet women in a match that many experts consider to be the best women's match ever contested. The end of the 80s witnessed the emergence of a new dimension for volleyball. Corporate sponsorship was growing rapidly, and by 1990, most of the leading players in the world were playing in the European pro leagues, particularly in Italy. Huge salaries and the collapse of the communist regime sent men and women to new opportunities. A result was the rise of Italy and the Netherlands as new forces in international volleyball. New stars were born. Players such as Andrea Zorzi, Ron Zwerver, and Lorenzo Bernardi became worldwide celebrities with six-figure incomes. The marketing and promotional efforts of the FIVB found fruit with the formation in 1990 of the World League, the first ever international professional sports league.
The World League has become the volleyball event of the year and the most successful one we have ever organized. Our point of departure were marketing considerations. Only countries that were prepared to deliver TV signals and provide sponsors were able to participate in the World League. The first year we started with $1 million prize money for 8 teams. Next year we were providing $2 million, and then we rise to $3 million, and successfully we arrived in 1995 to have $6 million prize money. It was a very successful adventure in the world of sports marketing. And besides that, we don't have any other event in which we have gathered from 240,000 spectators in 1990 to 630,000 spectators in 1995.
The spectators and the fans in the United States, they're great spectators, and I think they're some of the best fans around, but they just don't have the emotion that the Latin or the South American countries.
Also für mich das beste Publikum ist eigentlich Japan, weil die Japaner wirklich vom Volleyball sehr viel verstehen, weil sehr viele, auch die Kinder schon sehr früh anfangen, Volleyball zu spielen. Und mir gefällt es auch sehr gut in Brasilien, weil in Brasilien das Publikum einfach fanatisch ist.
Bom, para mim o melhor público
é o Brasil, pelo clima. É um povo que vibra, é um povo que torce. Você vai para qualquer país do mundo, é um povo que só aplaude, né? No Brasil, não, tem aquela coisa de fanatismo, de gritar, de bandeira, que é o próprio carnaval dentro do ginásio.
Look at the one loss statistics. The home team has a definite advantage in volleyball, and in countries where the fans are that crazy and that fanatical, it's got to be a big advantage.
In 1992, a women's version followed with the creation of the World Grand Prix.
After the success of the World League, women's team were claiming to the FIVB president a league of their own. They were asking us what we were doing in order to give the same status to women's competition. We created the concept of Grand Prix, and we found in Asia the right people to help us build up this concept. The Grand Prix is a tremendous success. Not only in Asia, we have played in other continents also. The top 8 teams are playing nowadays for $2 million prize money. And I am sure, I am convinced that Grand Prix has a great future and will flourish.
1992 was also an Olympic year. The games at Barcelona revealed great changes in the sport of volleyball. A young, dynamic team of Brazilian men charged to the gold medal, facing a new emerging power, the Netherlands. The Brazilian setter, Mauricio Lima, directed an array of soaring and hard-smashing attackers, such as Marcelo Negral, to defeat Ron Zwerver and his teammates. And for the first time, the wonderful athleticism of the Cuban women and the team superstar, Mireya Luis, prevailed to win that country's first Olympic gold medal in volleyball.
Pienso que la expresión nuestra ha sido el desarrollo físico. Creo firmemente, ¿no?, que nosotros en el voleibol femenino aportamos esa posibilidad de la mujer de alcanzar niveles muy altos en cuanto al aspecto físico que no se desarrollaron en otras etapas del voleibol internacional. Creo que ese es el aporte.
As the 100-year birthday of the sport approached in 1995, backward glances revealed startling changes. The sport had entered the computer age. The American, Netherlands, and Italian teams were using portable computers connected by local area networks to perform statistical analysis while a match was in progress. Coaching decisions grounded in this analysis affected a team's success. Yet the greatest factor in a team's success is the skill of its players. By 1995, the best players in the world were competing for millions of dollars in the growing World League and World Grand Prix. The fame of these top players crossed international borders. True international stars had been made.
Thank you.
But the most remarkable advance was in the sport's new offspring, beach volleyball. As the FIVB World Beach Series increased both its multi-million dollar purse as well as its international sites every year, the interest in beach doubles exploded.
The beach game is now surfacing in a very big way. I think it lends itself even more easily to sponsors and television than the indoor game. So you're going to find the beach game becoming very popular very fast.
The beach game is helping the indoor game. I think the beach is on TV quite a bit, and people love watching the beach.
I think the success of the beach volleyball in Norway is going to help indoor volleyball.
In 1995, the game was contested at some of the most beautiful locations on Earth. Finally, through the labors of Dr. Acosta, this fresh, exciting version of volleyball was accepted into the 1996 Atlanta Olympic Games. The Olympic beach volleyball venue for those games was unveiled in the spring of 1995. The best athletes from several countries were invited to showcase the sport.
Now the exposure it will get worldwide will mean that the sport of beach volleyball will explode. And I think the potential for beach volleyball to be bigger than indoor volleyball is very, very good.
You're going to see a lot of athletes giving everything they have over this next year and beyond for the sport.
I'm sure Mr. Morgan coming back in time would say, my gosh, what turned out to be a recreational, non-aggressive sport that was a counterpart to basketball is now an exciting, vibrant, great game played at all levels, all ages. It's a lifelong leisure sport, but it's a great spectator sport.
As the countdown to Atlanta begins, volleyball prepares to enter its second century with unbridled excitement. Television cameras from around the world will broadcast live images of the world's best players, both indoors and on the sand, back to their citizens. During its first century, volleyball has reached every corner of the globe, from the beaches of California to the mountains of Nepal. From above the Arctic Circle to the tip of South Africa, people play volleyball with skill and passion. For the next century, the only certainty is change at a mind-staggering pace. In a shrinking world, the game's original ideals, teamwork, cooperation, and communication, position the sport for spectacular growth. Perhaps this is still volleyball's lasting message, bringing people together in a healthy environment to enjoy friendly competition. That message is not too foreign to William Morgan's original idea. Just a little grander.